Good morning, Harvest. Good morning. How was everyone's spring break? Everyone's spring break good? Couple cheers. Other people are like, meh, it's just another spring break. I feel that. Well, actually, we just got back from a missions trip. I got back on Friday, and we took 40 students, and we left last week and just got back on Friday this week, and we took 40 students to the beautiful state of Tennessee, and we went to Knoxville, and there we were able to serve and love and share the gospel with so many people in the city of Knoxville and in the surrounding areas. I've got some pictures to show you guys. We got to spend time serving a church in Clinton, Tennessee, which is right outside of Knoxville, called Second Baptist Church. And while we were there, we were able to, they let us sleep in their building. How kind of them. It was really great. And don't worry, we had air mattresses. It was, so not like super uncomfortable, but it was nice. It was nice. And we were able to help them with some student events and some children's events. It was really great to be able to serve them in that way. We were able to go to downtown Knoxville and serve the homeless of Knoxville by packing and sorting items, and then going downtown and partnering with a couple of ministries, actually, and handing out food and clothing. And we packaged almost 400 individual bags of essential items for the homeless people. And can I just tell you, almost 400 of them. We gave all of them out. Every single one of them, our students packed, and we handed every single one of them out. And of course, we were able to have beautiful conversations, and we were able to pray with those people. It was an awesome time. We were also then exactly opposite of downtown Knoxville. We were able to go out into the mountains in the smallest rural elementary school in the county, and we were able to play music with them and have recess with them and have lunch with them and to read to them, very precious K through fifth graders, at a school called Bryceville Elementary School. And it looks like Bryceville, but that's not how they say it, and they make fun of you if you say it that way. It's not Bryceville, it's Bryceful. I don't know, that's just what thought that was a fun fact, so if you ever find yourself there, Bryceful. So we got to go and do that. We also had the opportunity to go and serve a widow who recently lost her husband to a coal mining accident. We were able to do some work in her yard, things that she was not able to do herself, and it was a really beautiful thing to serve her. And then we also served at a ministry called Choices Resource Center, which is a crisis pregnancy center, helping them out in a couple of special ways. And of course, we got to enjoy 70-degree weather the entire week, which was pretty outstanding. I walked off the bus on Friday in a t-shirt, which was a terrible idea because it was still freezing here. I had apparently thought things had changed in Chicago. They did not, still cold, but it was a great week of serving Christ with our students, and I think a very perfect picture of what we're going to see in the text today. And before we jump in, let me just pray for us, and then we'll get into God's word. God, we're so thankful to meet with you here. And Lord, we are so grateful that every single week we come here, you meet with us. Lord, I pray now as we open your word that you would stir our hearts to do exactly what James 1 says for us to do, Lord, to be not only hearers of the word, not only listeners of the word, but to be doers of the word. And you've got some things in your word for us today that we need to do. And so, Lord, would you stir our hearts, give us strength to do these things, help us to lean into the truth of your word this morning, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, the title of the message for today is Putting on Christ. And we're going to be continuing our series in Satisfied. And we are going to be in Colossians 3, chapter 3, verse 12 through 14. The title is Putting on Christ. And I saw our students this past week constantly choosing to put on Christ in his service. It was so beautiful. And Pastor Ed Ollie was here last week, and he did a great job preaching. So thankful for him. I was able to watch it while we were away. And he talked about the things that Christians need to put off, to put to death from the old self. This week, we get to talk about the things we get to put on. Because putting things off is good. Putting things off is good. It's a really good thing, but it's not complete. It's not complete. There's another part of the equation, and that is the putting on of some things, and that's what we're going to be talking about today. And so if you would join me in Colossians 3, verse 12, let's read together. It says, "Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other. As the Lord has forgiven you, you also must forgive. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. The first thing that we're going to see in this passage today about putting on Christ is, because I am chosen, I put on Christ likeness. Who remembers the two words when I preached 2 weeks ago? Who remembers the two words that I taught that help us understand and study the Bible a little bit better? Anyone remember? Show of hands. Okay, I need to do a better job of it this time. Okay, I got you. Does anyone remember it? Anyone got it? Okay, I see. Yes, yes. Imperative and indicative. I don't know who said it because there was a couple of people. Just see me afterwards. I'll give you a candy bar. That's what we do in student ministry. You know, if you get a right answer, you get a candy bar. Some parents are like, why is my kid come back home with such a sugar? They're like on sugar. And I'm like, well, it's because your student's smart and they get all of the answers right. I'm just kidding. But seriously, come and see me afterwards. I got a candy bar for you. I'm just, because I am chosen, I put on Christ's likeness. Yes, those two statements are, or the two words are indicative and imperative that help us understand and study the Bible in a better way. And we're gonna see both of those again right here in the passage. The first part actually says, put on then. That's the imperative. That's the command. That's the go and do this. Make sure that you've got this. Put it on. Put on. You took some stuff off. Now we need to put some stuff on. And then the indicative, the statements of who we are. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. I love that. That's who we are. God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. And give me a thumbs up if it's okay for me to just go off on a quick theological tangent. Is that okay? Thumbs up? Okay, I've got a lot of thumbs up. All right, so every time that I get to one of these passages where it talks about God choosing, we are God's chosen ones, or God chose us. Maybe I'm just weird and this just happens to me and alarm bells go off and it like transports me back to college when we used to have these arguments all the time about Calvinism and Arminianism. Anyone, does that happen to anyone else? Little bells? Yeah, okay, great. It happens, and all of a sudden I'm like, oh man, this is the argument right here that's been raging for hundreds of years. Who chose who? God chose us, we chose God. But the truth is, maybe that happens for you when you read passages like this, where that argument seems to play in your mind. But the truth is that no matter what side of the theological line you fall on, either of those positions, the truth of this statement remains the same. The truth of it is the same. And the truth is that your identity is that God chose you. In the Calvinistic viewpoint, it's before the foundation of the world, before you have ever done anything good or bad, God in a sovereign choice chose you. In the Arminian viewpoint, God peered through the corridor of time to see who would choose him and then retroactively chose them. In both of those, God chose. The truth is the same. God chose you. And the reason that I bring that up is because this is such a marvelous truth. How incredible is it that the God of the universe, the creator of everything, chose you. You who have decided to put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. He chose you. Doesn't that just make it seem like God is so near to us? Because he is. He's not some faraway God who's busy doing cosmological things. He is right here with us and he chose you. Your identity is chosen one, holy and beloved by the God of the universe. That's your identity. And it's such a beautiful, beautiful thing. And because of this amazing identity, we are to respond in an appropriate way. We need to put on some stuff. So it says, put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved. And really quickly, that phrasing, holy and beloved, is the same way that God refers to Israel in Deuteronomy 7, 6, and 7. And what Paul is indicating here by using those words is that we and the Gentile Colossian believers that he's writing this letter to, we now have the same kind of covenantal relationship with God that Israel did. A covenant that cannot be broken. It cannot be broken. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that encouraging? It cannot be broken. We have that covenant, that same type of covenant that Israel does and did with God. So awesome. So because of that amazing identity we have, we are to respond in an appropriate way. We need to put some stuff on. And Paul lists some great things for us to put on. Christ-like things, all of the things that Christ was, and he was more too. But these are some great Christ-like things for us to put on. First is compassionate hearts. Compassionate hearts. The literal translation of this word is bowels of mercy. And I'm really glad that they, in this translation of ESV, they changed that to compassionate hearts, because bowels of mercy sounds weird. It just does, right? It's just a little weird. I'll put it out there. Bowels of mercy. You see, many of us attribute the seat of emotions to our heart. We attribute it to our heart. But in ancient times, they attributed the seat of emotion to their stomach. It's where they felt emotion. They felt emotion in their stomach. When they were stressed, when they had anxiety, despair, when that happens, you sometimes get an ulcer in your stomach and it hurts, right? When you experience joy and happiness and love, what happens in your stomach? Butterflies, right? That's where you feel them. And so it's this beautiful picture. The wording is, you know, the picture is beautiful. And it's this deep inward conviction towards compassion and sympathy for others. It's a deep inward conviction of compassion and sympathy towards other people. That's what compassionate hearts is, the bowels of mercy. Being able to see people who have less than you, who are hurting, who are struggling, just like we were able to do this weekend with the homeless of Knoxville, and have sympathy and compassion, this deep inward desire to help them. And that actually leads us right into the next word, which is kindness. So compassionate hearts, kindness. Kindness is being helpful, being beneficial to other people. These two are very similar in that way. To be helpful or beneficial to someone else. When I see someone who needs help, who needs something, I'm running to that person and I'm helping them. That is kindness. I'm being beneficial to the people who are in my life. Compassionate hearts, kindness. The third one that Paul mentions is humility. And the Bible has a great definition for humility found in Philippians 2. And it says, to count others more significant than yourselves. That's humility. To count others more significant than yourselves. It's putting others before myself. It's having a low view of self. Now, please don't misunderstand that last thing that I just said. I did not say having low self-esteem. Okay, because that's not what humility is. Humility is not low self-esteem. Humility is not degrading yourself constantly. I'm not good enough. I'm not pretty enough. I'm not. It's not the constant degradation of myself. Humility is the recognition that in my flesh, I'm inadequate. And it's the recognition that I need God's help. I need God's help. It is counting others more significant than ourselves. Humility. The fourth one that Paul mentions is meekness. Meekness. Another word could be gentleness. Gentleness. Gentleness in our attitudes and in our behaviors towards other people. Another way to say it is not being harsh with people. Not being harsh, but being gentle with the people who are in our lives. Being gentle to one another. Being gentle in our response, in our behaviors, in our attitude. Gentleness. That's the meekness. And the last thing that Paul says right here is patience. Patience. If anyone has the King James Version, it is long-suffering. Long-suffering. And it is the idea of staying under, staying in spite of troubles and trials, especially those caused by others. It's long-suffering. So we have compassionate hearts. These are the things that we need to put on. Compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. These are all things that the Lord Jesus Christ is. He's all of these things and more. And so, because I am chosen, I need to put on Christ likeness. And I want you to notice something, is that Paul in here isn't saying, here's a list of some pretty good things. Now I want you to pick some, all right? Just pick a few, you know, it's like a grab bag. Just pick some. Which ones are you feeling today? You feeling meek? All right, grab some meekness. You know, grab some humility, grab some. He's not saying that. He He's not saying pick and choose. We need to put all of these on every single day. We need to put them on every day. We can't just pick and choose the ones we want for the day. It's not a grab and go of what you want. All of them need to be put on, because when I have all of them on, when I have all of these things on, when I put on Christ-likeness, then I am ready to live the Christian life day to day. When I put all of them on, I am ready to live the Christian life in the day to day. And I cannot miss any of these. I need to put them all on so that I can be ready. You know, I am a wrestler. I'm not. I used to wrestle. And you might be thinking, well, Pastor Tommy, what happened? A lot of stuff. I don't really want to get into it right now. And in wrestling, the main deterrent for people wanting to wrestle is the uniform that wrestlers wear. I have a picture of it. It's coming up right now. It's like the main thing that people are like, oh man, wrestling sounded fun. Then I saw that and I'm like, I have to wear that? I don't think I'm going to do that. And can I just really quickly, this right here, this is not a leotard, okay? This is a teaching moment for everyone in here. This is not a leotard. This is not a unitard. This is not a spandex suit, okay? The name of this uniform is a singlet. Thank you, singlet. That is the name, okay? Oh, okay, sorry, that's a lot of repressed. That came straight out of high school, I feel like, wow. Go put on your leotard. It's a singlet. Okay, sorry, I'm done with that. But this is the uniform that a wrestler wears. And in a certain style of wrestling called freestyle, which is what you would see in the Olympics, freestyle and Greco-Roman wrestling, they wear two colors, and that's it. There's no other colors that are in the singlet. It's blue or it's red. Those are the two colors. There's no crazy yellow, leopard skin, none of that. It's blue or red. That is it. And that's all that there is. And it's so that the ref can have an easier time dishing out points to each of the wrestlers, because they're flying through the air. It's crazy. Everything's going fast. And it's just easier for the referee to give points and for people to keep track of what's going on. And they are very strict about this color rule, okay? They are super strict. And so you'll see a lot of singlets are just like this. They're reversible. So one side is red, one side is blue. It makes it really easy. So you go and you look at the bracket, and you see which color you are going to be, and you show up to the table ready for your match in that color. Mom, you probably remember this. Yeah, it was really awesome. So I was at a national tournament, and there's thousands of people there. And I must have read the bracket wrong. That made it seem like it wasn't my fault. I did read the bracket wrong, and I put on the wrong color. I showed up in blue. And I, you know, got undressed and I was in my singlet and I looked over and my opponent was also in blue. And I'm like, ha, he got it wrong. Stinks to be him. And then I was informed by the people at the table that I had got it wrong. And I needed to change immediately into red. And I will not tell you how I was able to do that, because that's irrelevant, okay? Let's just say that it was very embarrassing, was it not, Mom? It was very, very, very embarrassing. I wasn't ready. I was not ready to go out into the mat and wrestle. I was not. And because of that, I suffered some pretty embarrassing consequences. But I wasn't ready. We need to be ready. We need to be ready to live the Christian life day to day. And we cannot forget to put the things on that we need to put on. We need to put on Christ-likeness, because when we fail to do that, we suffer some consequences. I wrote some down. What happens when I fail to put these things on? When I fail to put on compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, patience, when I fail to put that on, the first thing, I miss opportunities. When I'm not putting on a compassionate heart, which is the deep inward conviction of compassion and sympathy towards other people, I'm not looking with the eyes of Jesus. I'm not seeing things correctly in front of me. Maybe it's a busyness that's happening in my life. I don't have time to stop and to pray for that person or to help that person. I miss opportunities that the Lord is placing in front of me to serve him, to share Jesus Christ, to pray with, to love other people well. I miss those opportunities when I fail to put these things on. The second thing is I ruin relationships. I ruin relationships. When I fail to put on humility, when I fail to put on kindness, when I fail to put on meekness, I ruin relationships. My temper gets away from me. My ego gets away from me. My pride gets away from me. I say things I shouldn't say. I do things I shouldn't do. I ruin relationships. I need to be putting on the things that Christ has called me to put on. Number three, I put myself at risk to sin. When I'm not putting these things on, these things are like an armor to me. Putting on compassionate hearts and kindness and humility and meekness and patience is like an armor protecting me from the temptation of sin. And when I fail to put these things on, I am putting myself at risk in every situation to sin. Number four, I don't give others my best. I don't give others my best. Because truth be told, I alone cannot give people my best. I need the Lord. I need the help of the Holy Spirit. And I need to be putting these things on because when I do, then I'm truly able to give people my best and the Lord working through me, which is the even greater version of my best because it's Jesus Christ working in me and in you. And then the fifth thing is, and a devastating one, is I misrepresent Christ. I misrepresent Christ. Maybe you, at your job, the people know that you're a Christian, that you love Jesus, and you have, in some way, failed to put these things on, to fail to put Christ-likeness on at your place of work. Maybe you've said that you're a follower of Jesus. Everyone knows that you're the Jesus freak at the workplace, which is awesome that they know that. But when we don't put this on, and people see us have a short temper, not act in humility, not act in gentleness, not act with a compassionate heart. They're not seeing Jesus in us. We are misrepresenting Jesus Christ to the people who we told them we are Christ followers. God, help us. Help us to put these things on so we don't do that. So because I am chosen, I put on Christ-likeness. And yes, I am going to put these on and wear them for the entire sermon. And just bear with me. It's been a while since I've put on catcher's gear. It's been some time. This is what we need to be doing as Christians. Every single morning when we wake up, we need to be putting on Christ-likeness, compassionate hearts, kindness, meekness, humility, and patience. Got it. Here's the second thing we see in the passage. Because I am forgiven, I put on forgiveness. This is so clear in the text. Let's read it together. It's verse 13. Bearing with one another, which is simply means to put up with others' behavior and action, even if they are tiresome. So thank you very much for bearing with me in this sermon. Bless you. Thank you. Bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, you also must forgive. Forgiveness is such a tricky topic, isn't it? I think that we have such a hard time with forgiveness because we don't fully sometimes understand what it means and what it is. And so I want to try and bring some clarity first by defining what forgiveness is not. What forgiveness isn't. Forgiveness isn't weakness. Forgiveness isn't weakness. You may have thought before, man, if I forgive this person, I'm weak. I'm being weak. I'm giving them the authority to just walk all over me and do to me whatever they want. If I'm gonna forgive them, that's weakness in me. It is not weakness. Forgiveness is not weakness. It is the opposite of that. It is incredible strength to be able to forgive those who have hurt us. Another thing that forgiveness isn't is it isn't reconciliation. It isn't reconciliation. Being on friendly terms with another. It is not that. That is not what forgiveness is. Reconciliation and forgiveness are two separate things. and the Lord loves both of them, but forgiveness is not reconciliation. Forgiveness isn't immediate and complete trust. It isn't immediate and complete trust. If you have had your trust broken and you chose to forgive, it isn't going back and immediately and completely trusting that person again. That takes time to build and build and build. Forgiveness is not immediate and complete trust. Another thing that forgiveness isn't is putting yourself into harm's way carelessly. Maybe you've suffered a difficult and harmful situation in your life. And when we are called to forgive, it doesn't mean to go back into that difficult, hard, and possibly harmful situation carelessly. That's not what it means. Another thing, the last thing that forgiveness isn't, is forgetting everything that ever happened to you. That's not what forgiveness is. Forgiveness isn't forgetting everything that ever happened to you. So that's what forgiveness isn't. So what is forgiveness? Well, I wrote down five more things. Forgiveness is a decision. Forgiveness is a decision. Forgiveness is an emotion. It's not a thing that encounters me. Forgiveness is a decision. I'm making a choice to forgive. Another thing that forgiveness is that it is not conditional upon others' repentance. It is not conditional upon another's repentance. Just because the person who has harmed you has not come to you and repented to you does not mean that we don't forgive them. Even if they have not repented, the Lord calls us to forgive that person. And that's tough. That's really tough. The Lord really had to take me to the mat, wrestling reference, on this point right here of forgiveness this week, struggling with this. Another thing that forgiveness is, this is the dictionary definition, wiping the slate clean, to pardon, to cancel a debt. If you imagine it like it's a dry erase board, it's taking the eraser and wiping it clean. That's forgiveness, wiping it clean. Another thing that forgiveness is that it's an act of giving up my desire to hurt you because you hurt me. It's an act of giving up my desire to hurt you because you hurt me. And lastly, forgiveness is a command. It is a command. It is not something that we think about doing. It's not something that we maybe should do. This is a command from the Lord. Do you see it right here in the verse? Do you see it in the text? It says, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also, what's the word? Must forgive. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. This is a command. It's not an option for the believer. We must forgive the people in our life who hurt us, who sin against us. We must forgive them no matter what, no matter who, no matter how bad, we must forgive. The Lord calls us to do it. Because he has forgiven us, we need to put on forgiveness. You might be thinking, well, Pastor Tommy, you don't understand. You don't know what this person did to me. You don't know how they've sinned against me. You don't know how many times they've sinned against me. And you don't even know that they're continuing to sin against me even now. And you're right. I may not be able to understand. And I certainly don't know what that person has done to you or how they have sinned against you. And truly, I'm really sorry that happened to you. It's awful. And you could probably fill a book cover to cover with how that person has sinned against you and how awful they have been to you and all of the things that they have done to you. You could probably fill a 200-page book with that, maybe even more, of what that person has done to you. And while I may not be able to understand the severity of that and the constancy of that and the amount of that, do you know who does understand? God understands. God understands. Because for the past 30 years of my life, I have sinned against the Lord too many times to even count. So many times I have sinned against the Lord. Countless times. So many times, in fact, that I could probably fill the pages of these books with the amount of times that I have sinned. And I said probably. I did. I meant for sure. And my mom could be like, well, Tommy, that's about up until you were 12 years old. But I have sinned against the Lord an innumerable amount of times. And maybe your stack of sin looks similar to this. Maybe it looks different. Maybe it's bigger. Maybe it's smaller. I have more books. I'll put them on. We'll see how this goes. It fell over last service. That's why I'm a little weary. I'm just gonna put them right here. That seems like a good idea, right? More books. I have sinned against the Lord so many times, so often, so frequently, and so he understands. He understands perfectly what it's like to be sinned against. And the truth is, all of this, every book, every chapter of the book, every paragraph, every sentence, every word has been forgiven by God. He has forgiven me of every book, every chapter, every paragraph, every sentence, every word, wiped the slate clean. Everything is forgiven by the Lord. And I have sinned against him so greatly. Look at this. This probably doesn't even account for all of the sin that I have done against the Lord throughout my 30 years on this earth. And yet he has chosen to forgive me. And he's chosen to forgive you. And that is such a beautiful truth, that God forgives us, wipes the slate clean. And in comparison to the little book that I have of someone who has sinned against me, look at this. There is no comparison. There's no comparison between what God has forgiven me of and what God has called me to forgive others. Because you see, forgiving is not just obedience. It's imitation. It's imitation. Because God has forgiven us in such a greater way than we possibly could even imagine or think, we are to imitate God in this and forgive others. And while this is significant, it really is, and it hurts, and it is tough, and it is hard, God commands us to forgive in light of all that he has forgiven us of. Praise the Lord for the forgiveness we receive from the Lord. We receive it, and we need to give it. Because we have been forgiven, we need to put on forgiveness. We need to put on forgiveness. It's a hard thing. I just wrote down a couple of things to help us get to a place of forgiveness. How do I get to that place of forgiveness? The first thing should always be the first thing. Ask the Lord for help. Ask the Lord for help. God, please help me. I am struggling with forgiving this person. They have wronged me, and it wasn't right, and it was unjust. But Lord, please help me to forgive this person. The second thing is be reminded of all that God has forgiven you for. Think of specific examples of when you were the worst to the Lord and how he still forgave you and is still going to forgive you. The fact is that this is just the first 30 years of my life. There are more books to come, and God is going to forgive all of those as well. Because we are sinners and we fall short of the glory of God, and he is going to continue forgiving us because he is a great and loving God, and we are chosen by him to be holy and beloved, which is such a beautiful identity for us. Be reminded of all that God has forgiven you for. The third thing is pray blessing for the person. This one, wow, someone who hurts you, someone who wounds you so deeply. A helpful way to forgive that person and get your heart right on the matter is to pray blessing for them. Pray that God would bless them. That's a hard thing to do for someone who has hurt you, but pray blessing for them. Ask the Lord to bless them in their deeds, to give them abundance. It's a tough thing, but it is a help in getting us to a place of forgiveness. Number four, don't bring it up anymore. Don't bring it up anymore. Stop replaying the scene in your mind over and over and over and over again. That isn't helpful. That is not going to help you get to a place of forgiveness. It's going to help you focus on the injustice, which is going to keep you in a place of bitterness. Don't bring it up anymore. And finally, this, number five, make the choice. Make the choice. Choose to forgive. Sometimes that's all it takes. Sometimes we just haven't even made the choice. Choose to forgive. I am going to forgive. How do I get to a place of forgiveness? Make the choice. I need to put on forgiveness because I have been forgiven. I need to put on forgiveness. Put on forgiveness. Here's the last thing that we see in the text. Because I am loved, I put on love. Look at verse 14 with me. And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Because I am loved, I put on love. Above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Paul is emphasizing here, above all these. Another way to say it is above all else. The most important thing, more important than anything else, put on love. Put on love. Well, what is love besides a great song? I aged myself a little there. Again, the Bible has a great definition of this as well. And it's found in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4 through 7. It says this, love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. It's a beautiful definition of love, isn't it? And it's not just a self-sacrificing service for another person. That's not all that this love is talking about. It also has a component of warmth and affection and rejoicing towards others as well. That's the full picture of this love. Just a side note, in my Bible, in 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 7, I have just this little reminder in the margin of my Bible that says, love Kelly like this always. Kelly's my wife. And that might be a good reminder for you to place in the margins of your Bible. Obviously, don't put Kelly. don't do that. Put your spouse. Write down your spouse's name and say, always love my spouse just like this. Just like 1 Corinthians 13 tells me to love. What a great reminder for us. And it says that this love, above all else, this love binds everything together in perfect harmony. It binds it together. It's a fastener, a bond, creating unity, bringing two or more things together, tied to each other in perfect harmony. That's this love. So the question in the text is, well, what is everything referring to then? If it binds everything together, what's the everything? Well, some people think that it's talking about Christian community, which is beautiful and makes sense given the reference in verse 11 and in verse 15 of the body. But I believe it's referring to the immediate context of what's being said right here by Paul, which are the virtues that Paul just listed. Compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, patience, forgiveness, and above all, love, which binds all of those together in perfect harmony. I believe that it is the bringing of all of those virtues together in perfect harmony. Love is the greatest of these, binds them all together, unites them all together, and helps all of those virtues attain the full power by being empowered by love. Love is the key ingredient in unifying these all together. Do we have any bakers in the house? Okay, what's up? I'm going to attempt to bake right now. I already did the measurements for the flour and the baking powder and the sugar and the vanilla extract. I did all that because it required very specific measurements. And it would have taken me forever to do that up here. I'm a terrible baker. Can I just say that? So it's already prepared right here. I'm just going to put that in. So we have the flour, the baking powder, the vanilla extract, the... Can't forget. Butter. The butter goes in. What am I missing? The egg. Why is the egg so important to this? Whoa, you were all bakers. I didn't know that. The egg is the most, one of the most important pieces, the most important piece to making a, well, a cake that stays together. First off, it helps bind all of the ingredients together in perfect harmony. The problem is I only brought one egg, so this is gonna taste weird. But stirring this egg in to the mixture binds every ingredient together. It binds it together. It's what holds it together, helps this cake realize its full potential in being delicious. That's what the egg does. It binds everything together. And in about an hour and a half, we can all try that. I'm just kidding. We won't try that. You see, without love, these virtues start to fall apart. They fall apart because they can be seen as self-serving or selfish. Putting on a compassionate heart, kindness, all of those things can turn into selfish things. Maybe I'm doing this to benefit. Maybe I'm being kind to benefit myself. Maybe I'm being compassionate to benefit myself. Maybe I'm being humble so that I can show people that I'm humble. I'm doing it for all the wrong reasons. You see, without love, these virtues start to fall apart. But with love, it binds them all together and helps them to reach their full potential in the Lord, in Christ Jesus. These are all of the things that Jesus had for us. He wants us to put them on. And because God has bestowed such a great love upon us, we are holy and beloved. He has set his love upon us. Because I am loved, I need to put on love. So how do I make sure that I'm putting on love? I want to put on love. I want to be loving. How do I make sure that I'm doing that? I think a great way is to examine your motives. Why am I doing these things? Why am I putting on compassionate hearts, kindness, meekness, humility, patience? Why am I doing that? Forgiveness. Why am I putting those on? We need to ask ourselves some questions. Am I doing this because I want something from someone? Am I doing this because I'll feel better about myself? Am I doing this because it will help me in some way? Am I doing this to please others? Am I doing this to show everyone else, look at me, look at how spiritual I am? Or am I doing this out of love? The thing that binds all of the other virtues together in perfect, perfect harmony. Love, the most important thing. Love. Guarding the most important piece of my body, my head. And so now, I look ridiculous, but I'm ready. I'm ready for anything that the world has to throw at me. I am protected because I have put on Christ-likeness, I have put on forgiveness, and above all, I have put on love. I am now ready to live the Christian life day to day. To do what God has called me to do. And you have that opportunity too. To put on these things. Because these are the things that we need to put on as followers of Christ. And it's not easy to wake up day after day and put these things on. But God is so good to us, isn't he? And he gives us the Holy Spirit to help us in every step of the way. Amen? Amen. I'm gonna take this off now. And I'm gonna pray for us. God, thank you for your word. Thank you for the truth of your word. Thank you for the practical application that your word brings to our lives. God, help us. Help us to be ready. Help us to put on you, Lord, to put on Christ. Lord, help us to forgive. Help us to love. And help us to do it every single day and to put all of it on. Lord, help us to not miss a single thing so that we can be ready to live as a follower of Christ day after day, representing you to its fullest. Lord, help us now. We need your strength. We are desperate for you, Lord. We love you. We thank you for the work that you are doing in our lives. Help us this week, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name.